The show is about to start. Thank you for your cooperation. Enjoy the show, and please come back and visit us again.
Weeks where I could just play that song for its entirety and then probably just have a whole show of just playing songs. Unfortunately for everyone out there in podcast listener land, we are actually going to talk about stuff. You've got to put up with me and Stu this week, I'm afraid. So yes, Nick Draper is here with this week's late edition of the 9 Years podcast, joined, well, I was going to say once again, but returning to the podcast this week, the face of the BBC Sport website, Mr. Stuart Deakins. It is Saturday when we are releasing this said podcast, and allied with Stu not being here last week, we can only assume that you've been to see a lot of Priscilla over the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, I listen in to the podcast and had a chuckle with you and Chris. I don't know what you both were on or what you were both smoking or anything like that, but
drugs are bad, okay?
Yeah, drugs are bad. Yeah, I wasn't doing too much. I think I was just a little bit nervous. I'd had a bug for weeks, and I had finally lost my voice, and which I have to say is the most frustrating thing ever, losing your voice. Trying to talk to people when they can't understand a word you're saying. I suppose people were probably saying nothing changed there too much.
Do you lose your voice every week then?
No, but you know what? It was really frustrating because I lost it. Obviously, we travelled up to Bradford on Saturday, and I had to pick my moments to talk. And if I talked too much, I was coughing, and yeah, it really frustrating. You know, you really want to talk, and you're just like, I'll just shut up. And everyone that knows me just knows that I don't really stay quiet that long. So, but as you can tell, it's back. I've still got a bit of a cough, but I think the bug is gone.
Which is good. Which is good. In time for, and we'll start with this week, in time for a special birthday today.
Yeah, you got me thinking, yes, it is. It's my son's first year birthday. So, he's now, I think he's classed a toddler as of today. And he's a pain. He's up to everything now. He's full of energy. He's babbling. He's clapping now, which is great. So I'm getting the clap to AFC Wimbledon and stuff like that. So he smiles at that, has no idea, obviously, the cruelty that I'm teaching him. But yeah, special birthday. So he's 1 year old, and I'm actually pleased. I know he'll never understand it until he's older, but his first season as a Wimbledon fan hasn't ended in relegation. I'm quite chuffed for him.
Well, happy birthday, Thomas, for today. And when you say you've been teaching him songs and clapping, I am going to hope that you're not teaching him Alay, 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 because oh. I am on a mission to get this band, Don's Trust Motion, ban that song. Anyone singing it should be kicked out of the stadium.
Why have you got such a dislike? I know it's a Liverpool song, isn't it?
It's a Liverpool song.
Is that the reason purely, or we've nicked someone? We always moan, don't we, when we nick songs? Everyone nicks songs for everybody, don't they? But is it just because it's a Liverpool song?
Yeah, basically. It's a Liverpool song. And if you've seen, I've sent you that video of the Liverpool fans flying out to the Champions League final last season. Oh, how can you put up with that? So irritating. So irritating. That's what comes to mind every time I hear that song.
What I would say, though, the atmosphere has been better with it. I know we've got Wally at the wheel, and it'll be, I imagine, the fans that sort of created that song will be drastically trying to look at the release list and see, because obviously Ramsdale's not going to be here. And so, it'll be interesting to see how they're going to get it to now I can get it to fit next year. But the atmosphere has been better. But I know what you're saying. I know we used to moan like Stevie just come down with that horrible blimmin' song and it never stopped. And,
oh, my God.
Do you remember? I used to moan about that. But the atmosphere has been better. But, yeah, no, Liverpool song. Although, hey, Champions League, we're sort of taking over Europe, aren't we? All these English clubs taking over Europe with hardly any English players in them. That's another story.
When you say we're taking over Europe, doesn't appear to be much English about any of it, to be honest, but hey, might just be me. The fact that the clubs play their games in England seems to be the only thing that makes them English, to be honest with you. Anyway, let's talk about Wimbledon. And we stayed up. That's it, everybody. I've said that for a long time now. Never any doubt. Never any doubt whatsoever that we would be recording this podcast this week talking about Wimbledon as a League One club. So, can you go through your recollections and your emotions of that last game of the season away at Bradford last week? We will take Fear for Your Life in the passenger seat whilst my brother was driving for granted. Granted, we'll take it as read.
He done quite well, actually. Quite well.
Quite nice. Quite well.
We got there one base. It's always the main thing, isn't it? Emotions and stuff. It was really weird. I was reasonably nervous. But I think it was like, you know, because of the fact that we'd unbelievably put ourselves in a position where we were in the driving seat in terms of our own destiny. And it was really hoping that Bradford just wouldn't turn up and somehow just spoil what we'd done, really. But emotion-wise, yeah, I suppose once we realised that, I think once we got to 70 minutes, I was comfortable. I didn't really feel they were going to score. I was comfortable with that. But once it got to 70 minutes, then we put on another defender and literally held out for the draw, you were just hoping that, you know, it wouldn't end up biting you on the backside. But emotion-wise, a bit nervous, but at the end, celebrated. But I'll be honest with you, and I don't know if this is probably a bit, not controversial, because I don't like being controversial, but after 5 minutes, I then sort of reeled the anger got in and thinking, we had to stay up on the last day of the season with our best squad ever.
Strongest squad ever.
And I think the anger set in then really of, let's just get rid of the players that really don't want to be here and really haven't performed as we wanted. So a weird one. I celebrated, but it's been a rough season. I'm glad to see the back of it.
Oh, man, I'm so happy this season's over. I don't think I've ever been happier. Need a break. Yes, let's take a break. Let's go and get some frozen yogurt or something. I know what you mean. The big question for me, so I did with Kevin Boris last Sunday, did the Love Sport radio show. We talked on many things about the season, and we sort of touched on the subject of whether or not we clarify or consider this season a success. I came to the conclusion it was a successful season for Wally and Glyn, but on the whole, not really. If you stay up on the last day of the season on goal difference, as you say, you don't go into the season, you don't start on day one thinking stay up on the last day of the season on goal difference is going to be what we would consider success, do you? Now, clearly, the position we got ourselves in, it's a huge success. And everybody deserves immense credit for it. But, yeah, I'm kind of, I don't know. I've got such mixed emotions on this one. And I've got a philosophical point that I'll bring up a little bit later. But the question I started there with, in your opinion, Stu, was this a successful season?
It's difficult, isn't it? Because you don't want to sound ungrateful. But was it successful? Well, it's our worst league position in League One since we've been up. Do we class every season we stay in League One as a success? That's probably the question, isn't it? Because when you bear in mind the teams like Bradford, Scunthorpe, Plymouth, Walsall have gone down, you could arguably say have got bigger infrastructures with us, bigger budgets, and they've all gone down. So, you know, to be disrespectful, they'd probably be laughing if they were listening now thinking we don't think it's successful staying up. So I suppose, yeah, you know what? We don't know where we sit in a wage structure in terms of we don't know where we sit in a league table this year. We always aim to try and finish four positions above that. I just think, that's what I'm sure we'll get onto in a little while, but this season, there's still a lot of questions to answer. And it's not saying that the football club board should answer to the fans immediately, but it's been a season of mistakes, bad communication, even down to how we recruited. We got the right man in the end, but we now know that wasn't the first choice. And yeah, it's a bitty season. I suppose the reason I don't want to call it success is that I don't want us not to address the things that went wrong this season and mask it over and go, well, actually, we stayed up, so successful. Let's forget about what went wrong, because a lot went wrong this season. And Wally Downs, as if I'm being honest with you, got the football club board out of a little bit of a pickle.
It's a miracle that we stayed up, to be honest with you. I mean, for me, every season we stay up in League One is success. If you're asking me personally, Nick, do you consider staying up in League One a success every season, given, like you've just mentioned there, our infrastructure, size of stadiums, crowds we get, budgets, what have you? I would always say to you, we shouldn't even be at this level. We're punching above our weight being here. To have stayed here now for what will be at least four seasons is remarkable success. It really is.
Yeah.
My bugbear, as I've said to you for the past two seasons, stop going into... Oh, please, people at the football club listening, please stop with this pre-season trying to be ultra extra positive and getting expectations up. Because it wasn't our strongest ever squad. Absolute nonsense. The season before that, Neil Ardley was at fault when we were at Meet the Manager and he starts going on about top 10 finishes. Just shut up. Just be realistic and say, yes, come the end of the season, we would consider, and I know sort of Eric says, or he's not, obviously Eric's not in charge anymore, but he would say four places above our place in the budget table, which means at worst we'd finish 20th, which is exactly where we finished this season. But then we come out with statements like highest budget spend we've ever had, which automatically means we're well up that budget table from where we were. And then you get the statements about our best ever squad. And Neil was going on about it at the start of the season. He honestly thought this was the most talented group of players he's had to work with. And I don't think, because people will now look back and say, well, Wally's sort of proved that this squad is much better than it was doing. And it's all because of Wally. Well, I would say, I think Wally's got them to get enough to stay up. But as I've been saying over the last few weeks, watch our football over the last 2 months of the season and tell me that's our strongest ever squad and tell me that's a great group of players. No, it's just not.
Yeah, and you're right. You know, in terms of, I think we can all now safely say that Neil Ardley was trying to force the issue and trying to convince himself that he'd got the best squad. And we now know that the recruitment wasn't great. You know, even to the extent, let's be fair, when he signed Jake Jervis, he went on record and said that that was a player he wanted. I don't believe that for a minute. I think that's the last player that was available.
I think
with all due respect.
His fingers slipped and he swiped right when he was trying to swipe left.
But I think, you know, with Neil Ardley, yes, I think, you know what, I don't know whether the club's at fault for that in terms of Meet the Manager and what he said. I think Neil just literally was trying to convince himself, if I'm being honest with you, and we know how that ended. Yeah, you're right, you know, we should never be, you're right, we got promoted into this league well ahead of schedule. Were we ready for it? No. However, we stayed up in the league. So I don't think you should ever be ungrateful for surviving, no matter how. Yeah, and maybe, do you know what? People kept saying, it's not a failure if we get relegated. I think if people were honest with themselves, they just got used to being in League One, never thought we'd be in this sort of trouble, never thought we'd go to the final day. But maybe it's just a re-education of fans, really. You know, money, having the biggest budget, and I think that's why I chuckled to myself when the league table for finances had not been released, because normally Eric would release it every year to prove his point of how well he's doing. It was ironic this year how we never even got near it. We never mentioned it this year because we spent money this year. We spent the biggest budget. But what it proves, though, the biggest budget is actually it doesn't guarantee success. Actually, we finished worst on a bigger budget. And when you look at, like I said earlier, you know, Scunthorpe, Bradford having massive, bigger budgets than we had. And look what happened to them. They got relegated. So it doesn't necessarily say that your biggest budget wins you or guarantees you survival. I think the best thing we did, and you could argue that it wasn't our first choice, but we got two coaches in the window. So where you were saying about, you know, the strongest squad ever and people were saying, well, actually, no, the recruitment was good. Well, no, because if you really, and we will do an end-of-season review probably a couple of weeks or something like that, but when you break it down, what Wally did was got rid of a lot of the players that didn't want to be here or were causing a bad influence. He also, you know, Wally's a defensive coach. Glenn Hodges is an excellent coach. And what we did in the end was we just set up a system that made us hard to beat. Because you're right. Watch the Bradford game. Bradford dominated possession to us. And all we did in the end was knock long balls into channels. But we were hard to beat, and that's why we stayed up. But if we want to, if we want to watch that type of football week in, week out, then no, thank you.
Well, yeah, that's actually a bit of a very good point, actually, and it's a bit of a problem, isn't it? Because it's a means to an end this season, but you're right. Next season, people will not put up with it for 46 games. They just won't. Anyway, I want to get back to what Wally's changed. You started to discuss it there, but I want to get back to that a little bit later. Just to focus for a moment on that Bradford game in isolation. We went late, didn't we? We made a late substitution to go 5-4-1. We took off Joe Pickett, didn't we? I think we brought on Rod McDonald, if memory serves me correctly. Yeah. I mean, is that not an indication of Wally's, I don't want to say trust is the wrong word, belief maybe, in the squad he had that they could go out and win that game, and he thought the best bet was protect what we have and just see it out?
Yeah, he was just sensible in the end. You know, I was at the back of the, so I was on the side stand and reading to the back, and I could see Simon Bassey in the TV gantry, so he was up there with videoing and recording. And Waddy's quite interesting actually, because Waddy says that, you know, he told nobody to check the scores, didn't want to know what scores was. If I'm being honest with you, I looked at Simon Bassey quite a lot of times, and he was glued to his phone. So unless he was texting Waddy from there, I think we did want to know what was going on. But he was calm. You know, he said he needed a point, he needed a mirror, he needed really some real big scores to happen for us to be effective. But yeah, Bradford, if you were a neutral at that game, Bradford never had enough to beat us, never had enough to really get in behind us. Realistically, Aaron Ramsey had little to do. We probably had the best chance where we hit the post and then clear off the line. But it just, yeah, we're just very defensively, Waddy has set the team up excellently. You know, it just does the job. And you just can't, you know, we're unbeaten in eight games, end of season, unbeaten in eight games. So you have to say that, you know, end of the means, Waddy's basically made us difficult to beat. And we don't get beat. That's why we stayed up. You know, Plymouth or Scunthorpe or anyone like that had one of the downs, then they may have had a chance of staying up. But we've got a lot to do next season.
We do indeed. I'm just looking at the league table there. So, yeah, had we conceded, had Bradford scored, we would have dropped. We would have gone down. I get people saying and using that argument that a goal out of nothing for Bradford, yes, we could have gone down. I've been nervous. As I said to you for a little while, I think it was after Scunthorpe, when we won at Scunthorpe. I knew at that point we were going to be absolutely fine. The run-in was pretty favourable to us. And we said it would come down to beating Wickerman. And somehow we did it. The football gods certainly smiled upon us. I mean, just looking at the league table, though, 42 goals in 46 games. Not even a goal a game. The only side in the division not to average a goal a game. I mean,
yeah,
there's your problem.
You're right. It's when you look at the individual, you know, when you really break it down, you're right. You know, offensively, 42 goals. Bearing in mind, Luton scored 90 goals.
Yes, but Luton, as we all know, Stu, are amazing. So.
But yeah, it's really, yeah, you're right. 42 goals. The interest is the home form. We were the worst home team. 23 points at home. 27 points on our travels. And it's interesting, actually, when you really break it down even further, like, our waveform has basically kept us up. It's absolutely ridiculous in terms of, you know, when you go through the sequences, we unbeaten in eight away. You know, that's a team that's in relegation trouble, and they basically eight away unbeaten, won quite a lot of games in that way. And one of the things I was looking at, remember I always go about points per game, so we finished with 1.09 points per game. So just over a point per game we played. However, in the last eight games, we were 1.38 points per game. So a 26.6% increase. So we literally, the last eight games, we absolutely put the form on. That's what kept us up. That's why Plymouth and that couldn't live with us. That's why they were all, you know, scrapping around for results, because we put a squeeze on them. But we equally, you know, those stats for the last eight games, we've now got to find a way of being consistent. And it doesn't mean, you know, when I said about I don't want to watch that type of football next season, it doesn't mean I want to see a team like Bradford or, you know, who play lovely football and go nowhere. It's just about having, we have to be honest and say our attacking presence this season has been absolutely shocking. So the work defensively, I've got no doubt that Wally and Glenn can get a team working defensively. The trick in now, it's like when you, I always say, I always laugh when you play Football Manager, you play defensive 5-4-1, never coming out of your, box. You don't like attacking, do you?
4-5-1. I don't go 5. Okay. I'm not that bad. 4-5-1.
You don't like attacking.
I'd rather draw 0-0 than win 4-3.
Yeah. So, you know, if you look at our team this season, as probably in the 8 games, we're set up to not lose. But what we've got on now to somehow is fine-tune it and go, we now need to be a bit more, especially at home. You know, win your home games, be more offensive at home, take the game to teams. Not, you know, 1-0 and, crikey, I don't think we've got another goal. You know, Wickham home was the only time we really actually got a second goal because we've struggled before then with taking the leads and that. So there's a lot of fine-tuning to do. But, like I say, you know, we need to have confidence in our recruitment. We've got head of recruitment at the end of the season. It'll be interesting now to see what Dawes has done, really. Apparently, we have a player list of 1,000 people. Well, let's hope you and I are not on that list.
What? No, I want to be on that list. Stu, I'm only 25. I've got many years ahead of me. I can still do a job.
Hey, look, I can put 1,000 people on a list. Doesn't make it any good. Let's just hope the quality is on that list.
Whoever we get from that 1,000 will be the one we really wanted and we'll be delighted to have secured them as our number one target. Tom King, Jake Jervis. So you talked about defensive solidity, and that's one of the chief things, if not the key thing, that Wally and Glyn did was make us hard to beat. A lot of that ties in with the formation. I made the point on Sunday, I want to get your thoughts on it. Not the formation I think Wally would traditionally or normally lend himself towards. If he could, or if he had the players at his disposal, he would play perhaps a more expansive style. Does it come down to the fact, and I said this, that if you were to play, say, for example, a 4-4-2, he didn't think that we had two centre-backs and two centre-midfielders that, as a pair, or as a pairing, or as pairings, would be secure enough defensively? Is that a lack of quality in the squad then? Is that what it boils down to?
Yeah, possibly. I sponsor Glyn Hodges' away kit, so we had obviously a sponsored meal Tuesday before the Bradford game. And I'm not going to say everything that I spoke to Glyn about, because obviously some is not confidential, but, you know, you have a chat and you sort of say everything that he said. But I'm happy to share this. I did ask a question about 3-5-2 because, as you know, I've sort of said, you know, no matter what injuries we get, I don't think we're changing formation. I think the formation was set. And I did ask him and said exactly the question, you know, did you, you know, whenever you got an injury or anything, was it always going to be personnel you change rather than go to a 4-4-2? And he mentioned to me that when they come in, he said that Wally and him are both 4-4-2 men, both like to play two forwards up front. But when they come in, they had to look at the squad, and actually what they realised was is that we got overloaded in midfield quite a lot with the two, and that we lost too much ball, we weren't too solid enough. And then when they looked at it, actually what they wanted to do to play two forwards was to actually put three in the middle, in the midfield, but actually three in centre-half, we had good centre-halves. And the three worked well with the wing backs, and it just suited the squad that we had. So by that, I've got no doubt that we're probably going to try and do 4-4-2 next year. He said he wanted to play two forwards, and incidentally, he acknowledged what I think a lot of us all know, is that Piggott can't play up on his own as a target man. So they had to try and find a way of getting two up front, but the right two. So if you remember, we brought Falivi in. Falivi played with Piggott. And Hansen got fit. We brought Hansen in. So, yeah, I think they will play 4-4-2 next year. I don't think they are 3-5-2, but it was an end to a means. And you have to say, it's quite in a day and age we live in where we say no one's got any plan Bs. It's quite mad to think that they've gone away from their real sort of 4-4-2 background, found a formation, and got it to work.
Means to an end. Sorry, I just have to say that. The pairings in midfield, if you go 4-4-2 then, I think we'd probably look at centre midfield then as where you'd look to recruit next season. That's what we're expecting. I mean, we can come back to that in a moment, but what about the centre-halves? Like, I mean, do you recruit in that position? So you've got Nightingale as it stands, we expect, Nightingale, Callum Bailly, Thomas, McDonald. I mean, there's four centre-halves there. Do you think he recruits? Do you think he will go with two of those? If he goes with two of those, do we perhaps start to see players that aren't as strong as they have looked when they've got three centre-halves? Does that make sense?
Potentially, but it's the balance, isn't it? So remember what I was saying earlier about the fact that we've got to try and be more offensive. Difficult to be offensive when you've got three at the back.
That's the team, not the podcast we're in.
Yeah. Well, yes, let's move on from that. But I think you have to also look is that the fullbacks weren't as strong as... So we had Sibbick and Watson. We're being honest here, they're both not good defenders. You know, Sibbick doesn't want to defend. Most fullbacks nowadays don't want to defend. That's not always their strongest attribute. On the left side, as good as Steve Seddon is, I don't think he's a great defender. And I think he got proved that against some of the better sides. Luton, people said he got roasted at Luton. I think it's really harsh to say that because I think Luton roasted many players. Actually, let's rephrase that. Luton, you know, they possession football very quick. They've made a lot of good defenders look average. So I think it's harsh to have a go at Steve Seddon on that. But he's not a defender. You know, look at both our fullbacks. Look the most uncomfortable defensively going forward. They're great. Obviously, Steve Seddon goes back to Birmingham and Sibbick. I don't know where his position is. You know, maybe play a wing back. He plays there, but I don't think we're going to play a wing back next season. Sibbick, sometimes the great thing with young players is that they can sometimes have a close season in the summer, work on, you know, strength, body strength, that sort of side of it, and they can come back looking, you know, 10 or 20% better than what they were at the end of last season because they're progressing. So we may try and go with Sibbick. I think we're trying to get a bit more experience in the fullback areas, not too much because he wants a young squad. But yeah. You go with two centre-halves. At the moment, Will Nightingale, we all know, is negotiating, don't we? What's his strongest pairing? Hey, Will Nightingale, one other. Terrell Thomas is well thought of at the club. So that's probably what I would go. But you want to have competition, don't you? So having Ron McDonald there as competition and Paul Cannon by there, that's not the worst thing to have.
Argument that Rod McDonald could go left-back, back four.
He could do. He looks comfortable at left-back, doesn't he, on that side of it. So... yeah, there's no problem with that.
Midfield then? I mean, I don't know. Hartigan, Wordsworth, Wagstaff, Pinnock potentially could play centre midfield, but the fact he hasn't probably tells you all you need to know. I'm expecting movement there. I'm not sure. Wordsworth, I've loved Wordsworth in this run-in, and he's actually ended up on our shortlist for Player of the Year, but as a two-man midfield with him there, I'm not sure. I want him more advanced and freed of the defensive responsibilities, chiefly because the man can't tackle. He just can't do it. It's hilarious. It's like...
Well, he tries to, doesn't he?
Roadrunner and Coyote. It just never catches him.
Well, look at his bookies this year. I think he's got 11 bookies this year. And they've all been for late tackles. Although, I have to say, he left his best booking for the end of the season because the booking he got at Bradford was just comical. He got caught out. He took a tactical foul. But he literally rugby tackled. The player was never going to get away from him. It was the funniest yellow card I've seen. The best yellow card because it was the right thing for him to do. But he picks up yellow cards like they're confetti. I think he played...
To pick up confetti, it's actually very difficult.
Especially when it's stuck to the ground. Does he play a diamond in that midfield, for argument's sake? You know, does he play a wingers next year? It was 4-4-2, but it doesn't necessarily mean you play a wingers. Because he didn't really play with his wingers like this season were his fullbacks, weren't they? You know, in terms of Seddon and Sibbick. So he could play a diamond in there quite easy. And I think diamond wise, Wordsworth would play well at the top of a diamond. You need that defensive midfielder, like the old Danny Ballman, really, don't you, to sweep up. Player I like who's got just released by Bristol Rovers, the caveman. It looks like a caveman. He's a shave. Sinclair, I believe, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I like him. Mm-hmm. Again, he might be a West Country boy and not want to move out of there. But yeah, you need that defensive midfielder. Is McLaughlin that defensive midfielder? Don't know, because he's come in and Waddy hasn't really played him that much, has he? Hartigan, I think, stays. I don't think we're going to want to get rid of him because I think he's got a lot to offer. But yeah, we are a bit like Pinnock. He's not a midfielder. I don't know what... Pinnock is the interesting one of the summer, isn't it? Because he's got to do... He's really got to come back in. He's got to do what he done this season. Come into pre-season and really impress. He had a great pre-season. You wonder whether Wally... Would he stay? We paid a fee, I suppose, so we're not going to want to release him if we paid a fee, but he's the one I'm not sure of.
great pre-seasons. I tell you, this is why I don't bother with pre-seasons. It's normally the left-backs. It's Andre Blackman and Derek Duncan and all this stuff that looked amazing, and then it came to the real thing that's like, Anyway, where do you want to go from here? Just last thing I'll touch on, Bradford game then. So, you mentioned there was no real threat there. Were you, how much of the other scores were you personally keeping an eye on? Because I was sat at home watching Southend versus Sunderland, and at one stage I worked out something along the lines of Southend, I think it was Southend, Walsall, and Bradford would all have to... Oh, no, it was Plymouth at the time, sorry. Southend, Plymouth, and Bradford would all have to score at that stage of the game for us to go down. And then as soon as I said that, Plymouth scored, and then almost a minute later, Southend scored. But I still didn't actually think we were going to go down or concede. But was that, what was the atmosphere around you in the stadium when news was coming through of Plymouth winning, Southend winning?
Yeah, it was a good atmosphere, actually. I think we took loads up there, didn't we? And it was mad to have, like, the side and also behind the goal. It was really weird, that sort of dynamics of the sort of cheering and stuff. But, yeah, early on, I think there was goals coming in. You could hear celebrations. We obviously knew Plymouth went two up, and then we knew Scunthorpe come back. But I think we all knew, realistically, that it was in our own hands. Really, it was up. If we could see the goal, then that was us over. I think we all sort of knew that. So I think in the end, we just got behind the team. And the atmosphere was really good. I never really sensed a nervous energy or nervous atmosphere until probably 5 minutes to go, really. Bradford had a few corners. Didn't really do much with them, but you, a set piece, you're always vulnerable. We sort of saw it out. You know, we knew what the score, we knew the scores that were going around, but we sort of just knew, really, last 10 minutes, if we conceded, then that was game over. So it wasn't really much about what was happening elsewhere. It was just really what was in front of us. And the only nervous we got was when we didn't get the assistant referee putting the ball up for how many minutes to go. So we literally were in a little bit of a, when are you going to play whistle, ref?
Yeah, I was on Twitter and saw Bradford had tweeted that it was... The 90 minutes were up, but no board had appeared. Don't know what that was about. Probably something to do with, I don't know, modern technology in Bradford. Two don't really go hand in hand. They're not natural bedfellows, are they?
It's mad to think a club the size of Bradford are going to be in League Two next year. You know, I've always said it doesn't really... Your fans don't play the football for you. It's 11 players on the pitch. But it's a big club. It's too big a club to be in League Two. And whatever's gone wrong there, because you look at their squad... You know, when they've got like a TV, not a jumbotron, because it isn't that big, but it does all the players and stuff like that. And when you looked at it, you thought, how is this squad ever close to being, you know, why are they bottom of the league? It's just unbelievable, really, do you know what I mean? But I, finance-wise, you can see them being strong next year.
So aside from formation, what else did Wally do to turn our season around and keep us in the division? What were his keys to victory? Oh, my God. You know what? In my head, that sounded so much better than when it actually came out. Oh, my God. I've just cringed at how... Oh, Jesus. Can we edit that out? That's terrible.
No. I think, Joe, you know what? I think he just sussed the team out. You know, for all... And it's, you know, Neil Hardy did a job for us for, you know, the years, for what, 6-7 years he was here with us. Did a great job, but just run out of contacts for recruitment and just run out of ideas. I think when he come in and he quickly sussed out the players that wanted to be here, who had maybe the mental strength to be here, who worked hard on the training pitch, listened, and basically done what he asked. Because he was ruthless during the season. There's no doubt about that. You know, he was ruthless with a lot of players and took them off. But he trusted the kids. And, you know, to have Paul Cannon-Baye, Toby Sibbick, Annie Hartigan, all come through, and even going back to Burry, is it Burry? Burley, I don't know what his name is at Charlton. But he wasn't frightened to bring players in if they did the business. But equally, you know, let's be honest, you know, let's not beat around the bush. He got players away from the squad that he just didn't want around. Jervis, Apaya, Deji, they were nowhere to be seen. Tom Sawes. I don't think Tom Sawes was a bad influence.
No, but I mean, with
Trotter left to America, we pushed Trotter as far away as possible, so there was no chance of him coming back. But I think he sussed it out really early, the players that he needed or the types of players that he needed.
You say that, like, Trotter obviously was, I mean, his days were numbered. As soon as Neil left, I mean, he was gone, basically.
Yeah.
Bassi benched him straight away. Kwezi, Deji, Jervis, they all played and did well under Wally for a little time. Jervis scored goals, as ridiculous as that might sound to some of our listeners. Kwezi was scoring goals. Kwezi was doing well. So, and then Deji was Deji. But was it on the field where he had his problems with them? Or did he fall out with them for other reasons? And this is pure speculation now. We can expect.
You're right with Jervis. Yeah, he obviously scored away to Wickham, didn't he, and stuff like that. But that's before the window opened as well, wasn't it? So obviously Ramsdale, the genius. But I don't think that's down to Wally. By all accounts, we tried to get Ramsdale in before Tom King, but he got an injury. But he brought in some players, you know, brought Connolly in, brought McLaughlin in, brought Ramsdale in, brought Falivi in. So I think when he brought the players in and then brought the competition in, he saw how people reacted. Kwezi did do well. You know, obviously scoring away in the cup to Fleetwood, scoring. Yeah, he did do set up a goal for West Ham.
Scored at West Ham.
Yeah, but then after that, you know, Deji quickly became out of favour, got injured. I just feel he finally sussed out the players that he wanted. And it's no secret that the last part of the season, Jervis was nowhere to be seen. You know, it was like a case of where's Jervis, not a where's Wally thing. Kwezi, nowhere near the squad. Deji, nowhere near the squad. So in the end, he was quite ruthless when he wanted to know, are you in with us? Not saying they're bad influences, but it was all about that team spirit, and that was just as much as sticking together helped us.
And of course, the goalkeeper. We can't get away from this.
Yeah.
Huge, massive. I mean, I threw out a tweet, which was, you know, just food for thought last week, which was we drew 5 of the last 6. And had we not got that equaliser at Luton, had Ramsdale not made 3 outstanding saves at Oxford, Billy Keane not missed a penalty, then any one of those goes against us and we have actually gone down. Now, of course, this is, I mean, geez, you can go back and forth on these things. At the end of the day, we finish and you finish where you deserve to finish, and that's where we deserve to finish. We deserve to stay up. And of course, you could argue games that with a click of the fingers we could have won instead of lost. I mean, pointedly, as I made the point, of those 5 games that we drew of those last 6, well, 4 of them, people were saying, what a missed opportunity. We've blown it. We're not going to stay up if we can't beat these teams. Accrington people were saying it. Oxford people were saying it. And Bristol Rovers people were saying it. So,
yeah, there were big moments. Yeah, you can't argue the Luton game was massive. You know, we all know we still have a goal difference. And you could say that's... Be right, there were moments throughout that when we picked up a point at Oxford. We picked up a point at home to Accrington when, hey, look, they had a 5-minute spell where we could have been 2-1 down and down to 10 men. That was that 5-minute swing that we had. Ramsdale, you can't argue. Hey, look, without Ramsdale, we ain't anywhere near close to staying up. Let's not kid ourselves. And whoever comes in next year, we always thought, remember we said that we replacing George Long is going to be really tough for a keeper. Well, you're basically going to try. Whoever comes in now is technically racing a goalkeeper that we feel. And we don't say this lightly. I know we always laugh saying England's number one. But let's be honest with you, we'll be all amazed if he doesn't get an England cap in the future, because he's just been excellent at 19, which is ridiculous. But yeah, big moments, Luton, big one, Seddon. I think it's all accumulated. It's just that never-die attitude. It's that togetherness. It's not, you know, Luton should have been out of sight. But we just done enough to stay in the game. By hook or by crook, we stayed in it, and we never gave up. We scored late, and we scored a lot of late goals. You know, think back to Rochdale when we won 4-3 there. We got a late penalty set and went down late. We just never knew when we were beat, and you have to say that comes in from Wally and Glynn of what they build a squad up to do.
So many things you say suddenly lead me off in random directions and seemingly random directions. I was going to stop there pretty much on that talk, but then You mentioned Rochdale. My mind did not go to the 4-3, somewhat ridiculously. It went to the 1-0 draw we had with them at home earlier in the season, and an equaliser scored by Andy Barcham. Has his omission from the squad over the last couple of months, is that the... We talked about Pinnock being a question mark this season. Is that the biggest mystery of this season, where your longest-serving professional, technically, suddenly becomes invisible?
Yeah, not really, because it goes down to the formation again, doesn't it? You know, Andy Bartram can't play anywhere else but a winger. Can't play a wing-back. Same as Pinnock. That's why Pinnock never got in the squad, because he's just a winger. Even though he come on at midfield on Saturday at Bradford and done all right, actually, to be fair. I think it's just simply they were so stubborn in the fact that they had to find a formation, a tactic to get the best out of what we had. And I go back to this, but I think it's a really big point. You know, what he said about when he was in India, every year they got a new team. You know, they had the locals, and I think they were allowed 5 or 6 foreign players. And his job every year was to get a new squad of people playing together. That experience in India has been priceless, because that's what he had to do here. He had to find a way of getting his squad playing together in the best system. Bartram was basically a victim of that, because he can play a winger, and we didn't play with wingers. So I don't think Wally bombed him out, and I think he'd have some very nice words to say about Bartram, because he's an excellent professional and done a great job for us. But I think we all expect him to be on this release list when it's finally released.
The released list. I can't even speak. The released list. The release list. When it arrives, if it's released, as you say, will they release the released list? Please release me. Let me go. I don't know what's happening with that. We'll come on to that in a second. Last thing I want to say. This is my philosophical point that I alluded to earlier. Just got me thinking. There's lots of celebrations that we stayed up on the last day. Is not being relegated, here's my question, is not being relegated a victory? Should therefore we be celebrating if we haven't won? So basically we've celebrated away at Bradford because we haven't lost. And isn't it ironic that all during Neil Ardley's time over the last 18 months, people, including ourselves at times, have been criticising him for setting up his teams not to lose, and then basically we have celebrated at the end of this season not losing, because relegation would have been a loss.
Yeah, it's the same thing though, isn't it? Do we judge success staying up? It's the same. I don't think you can help but celebrate. But you know what? I sort of alluded to earlier, the celebration for Fleetwood on the last day of the season when we stayed up, that was a bigger celebration than this one. Because Fleetwood, we had a squad that wasn't very good. You know, and how, you know, Neil Ardley done a great job in putting a playoff form together to get up. And obviously, because we were new to League One, it did feel like a celebration that we'd avoided relegation. But not saying that we have a right to stay in League One, but, you know, all the things this year, we've already gone through it, you know, the strongest squad and the biggest budget, and we are a League One team now that's, can you say you're established after 3 seasons? Maybe. But, you know, none of our fans are expecting to go down. So I think you have to celebrate it. But I would probably say that the celebrations weren't as long-lasting as Fleetwood were. I know mine weren't. I'd probably say 5 minutes. And I was like, okay, look, let's just get a release list out. Let's move on. Forget this season. Actually, that's wrong. Let's not forget it, because we need to learn from it. But can we please sign? I just think recruitment, we moaned about it. Recruitment is the biggest thing I want to see rectified in the summer.
Yeah, we've got nothing to go on at the moment in terms of players that have gone. We don't know what's going on. It's been a strange week where we've been expecting, and we were told to expect big news early in the week, and that's turned into no news whatsoever. I think, well, I guess there's a list of players we can look at that we know are out of contract and we will probably not see again. Ignoring the loanees, Ramsdale, Falivi, Seddon, Jervis, won't see them again. We anticipate Bartram's gone. We expect to hear that Tyler Bury has decided not to sign a new contract. It's just whether some of those players, we don't know the situation. We expect Deji will go. Quasi Pie still got another year to go. Don't know what's going to happen there. And I'll just be interested to see, like we said, we mentioned with the new signings that came in this season and what happens with them. I anticipate Thomas and McDonald aren't planning on going anywhere, and neither's Wally expecting to send them anywhere. Wordsworth the same. Scott Wagstaff, don't know. I guess it comes at these situations, if you've still got time on your contract at this level, it's either a case of someone comes in for you and pays money. Not sure which of those players in our squad that would apply to. Piggott, possibly. Or you come to terms like we did with Cody McDonald last season and say, let's just come to terms on an agreement and cancel it.
Yeah, and I think, do you know what, I think the way I look at it, I think the forward line is the biggest thing we need to look at. So you're right, the players you mentioned, Deji and Atwood will go, and Wagstaff, not too sure, a lot of energy, but I think Wally will probably feel he can get better for the money that he's paying, probably. I think the forward line is the biggest thing. Obviously, Jervis goes back to Luton. Thank you. Thanks very much for that.
It'll be a very, very short return to Luton, I promise you.
It will do, but it finally gets... Hey, look, the loan market works sometimes. It doesn't work sometimes. It didn't work for us, and we paid a price for that. But I think Henderson will go back. I think we're probably... He's definitely got a year left in his contract, I would have thought. I would have think we would come to some sort of... I don't know if we will be as... not stupid is a word, but I don't think we're canceling his contract and paying him off. I think we're putting him on for a transfer, and I'd have probably thought Bradford would quite happily take him back. So I expect Hansen to go back. Quezzy, year left his contract. I think his days are numbered. I have a feeling that we will put him on a transfer market or loan list for the season, and that way we should hopefully get that off the wage bill. And hey, look, people will laugh at me, but I would, you know, what he said in the Man of the Match in the season, that we had bids in for Piggott during the summer, sorry, during the January window. That was when, to be fair, he didn't have half the goals he had now. I expect there to be attention for him in this window, and I would sell. Mainly because you sell your players when you sell the players when they are the most valuable in terms of the money you can get from him. He's got, I think, 2 years left his contract. We command quite a good fee, and I'm fed up with losing players for nothing. And we have to try and get a model where we don't feel that we hold on to them because we're desperate. I'm sure Wally Knack can find someone else with the quality of Piggott, and we let him go.
Joe Piggott is on our shortlist for Player of the Year. This is going to be a very easy conversation for you and I believe, Stu. We probably need to revisit this at a later date, potentially in the next couple of weeks with an extra special podcast, maybe. We'll see. Because I think we need a counter-argument when picking a Player of the Year. I don't think either of us are going to put it forward for anyone else than Aaron Ramsdale to be Player of the Year.
Yeah. Hey, do you know what? I'll be truthful. I was really surprised that Joe Piggott got Player of the Year. Really surprised. Normally, never a surprise when you get them. But I'd be truthful, not that I think he had a bad season. Crikey, he was our top goal scorer. But I was just amazed with the calibre of players we had around us that, you know, Joe Piggott beat them. But Aaron Ramsdale, I don't know any argument you can... What weaknesses has he got? I don't really understand. There was not many weaknesses in his game. I don't know where you get a counter-argument for it.
I guess the counter-argument is purely Joe Piggott, because, as you say, he's our top goal scorer in a team that only scored 42 goals this season. So to score double figures, as many as he did in that struggling team, I get the argument that he was here all season and Ramsdale wasn't. So
yeah, I just don't feel, though. Some people say that his goals, Piggott's goals won us, I don't know, 20 points, 10, 15, 20 points. But I don't feel that Joe Piggott done enough in games to really win games. Whereas Ramsdale, let's be fair, sometimes he was literally... there was no point in having forward sometimes because the ball would come back. It was literally like a one-man display sometimes. And yeah, and I think for me, Piggott's never really... and this isn't a have a go at Joe Piggott because it's not meant that way. But for me, I've just never really... I think, you know, sometimes Danny Kedwell's this world and John Maines and Bayo and All I thought was, yeah, Tom Elliott. So Lyle Taylor.
Oh, my word. How long did that take you to get there?
Well, I was trying not to mention.
First out of your mouth?
I get abused on social media for Lyle loving, but for me, he's just... I don't feel the fans have actually taken to him. He scores a goal and we sing his song. Apart from that, he doesn't get involved in the game enough for me, apart from his goals, which makes you laugh because, you know, Gary Lineker got a career off that by not even getting goals out of the area. He'd always get his goals inside the area. But I just think, you know, Aaron Ramsdale built up such an affiliation with Wimbledon fans and actually got that atmosphere going generally by his enthusiasm and for a lone player to get us and fight so willingly for the club who's only on loan, yeah, not see that too many times.
Last point I want to make on players and squad, really, Joe Piggott, the last thing I want to say about him. Something you said earlier in the season, a lot earlier in the season, you said you tend to find that he scores in streaks and in batches, and I think that point has been proved, because don't forget, a long spell of this season, he didn't score. In fact, I think he ended a bit of a dry spell against Halifax, didn't he, in the FA Cup, and scored for a little while, and started the season well, ended it well. The middle bit was... Say no more.
Look, if you look back from January, if you do a season review and you look from January only, because let's be fair, it's the only... You don't go too far back because you have nightmares. But Joe Piggott, there's no argument. He plays a massive role in a lot of games for goals, but they're goal highlights. I just think if you think about the game as wholes, Ramsdale is more influential. And even in my argument would be Will Nightingale is even more influential, just because of we just had to defend for our lives sometimes.
Should we have a look back at our predictions pre-season? Should we do that now?
I have heard them. I think I didn't do too bad.
Normally, this is the time, listeners, where I'll go through all our pre-season predictions from various members of the podcast team, and I'll do the little sound effect to say whether they were correct or not. The honest answer is I don't have the time to be doing that for this week, I'm afraid. Just don't have the time. I know it's Saturday because we've made a big deal of it being on a Saturday this week with the podcast and what have you, but really, I don't know what day of the week it is. And people, four-day week can suck my toe because it's been a six-day week for me. And I'm...
Are you moaning about working?
Do you know, can I just say, yes and no. We've got half term in 2 weeks. I will say is that's why I kind of think, do you know what? Yes, this has been the longest. The last couple of weeks have been insanely busy. It's been ridiculous. But don't mind it because half term is 2 weeks away. But anyway.
Don't you get like 8 weeks off soon?
No, that's a myth. That's an absolute myth, as we all know.
What, it's 10 weeks?
10 weeks?
Well, it feels like they're off for ages.
I don't know, I've not done my maths yet, Stu, but I know that it's probably about 4 weeks, and then I'm in pretty much from there, to be honest with you, because exam results days and all that business falls on my head now, so there we go. Anyway, got to run through these predictions very quickly. Podcast pre-season predictions, let's see who won these. Chris Draper, champions, Sunderland, runners-up, Charlton, Nilpot. Playoffs, Chris, you might not want to listen to the next couple of minutes of this podcast when we review your four picks for playoff teams. Oh my word. Oh my days, as we said before. Southend United. Plymouth Argyle.
Ouch.
Bradford City. But then, bizarrely, you get a point for Portsmouth. I don't think you should have a point for getting one playoff team from four correct, two of which were relegated, one of which was getting relegated until 3 minutes before the end of the season.
Yeah, he's had a nightmare there, hasn't he?
That is shocking.
He's had a Ben Wilson, hasn't he?
That is really, really poor. We didn't score against Ben Wilson this season. I'd just like to point out, we did not score against Bradford this season, the worst team in the division. We didn't score against him. Keeping up a proud record of being rubbish against the relegated teams. But not bad against the pro teams. That's strange. Anyway. 1 point there, Chris. Scunthorpe, you said, would finish 14th. No, it was Accrington Stanley.
Accrington Stanley?
Who, coincidentally, Chris, you predicted would be relegated. No, they weren't. Neither were Wickham, Gillingham or Rochdale. You said we'd finish 19th, we finished 20th. 1 point for Chris. Last year, he won this game. He won the predictions contest. This year, it's going to be unlikely that he's going to finish anywhere other than bottom. The same bottom that he fell on at Bolton away in 2001. Not that we like to mention it. George Jones is next. I'm not sure if we do George's predictions because we've sacked him.
Cool. That's good. He can't win.
He can't win. Let me just quickly scan my eyes over what he's gone for. A point for saying Portsmouth will be in the playoffs. 2 points relegated Warsaw. 3 points relegated Bradford. 3 points for George.
He said Bradford get relegated?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Who would have thought that?
I think a couple of us did, actually. Stu, as you'll find out shortly.
Okay.
Kevin gets points for saying Portsmouth in the playoffs. 1 point for that. You did put Scunthorpe in there as well. Wimbledon 14th, no. Relegated, a second point for Warsaw. Wimbledon to finish 14th. 2 points for Kevin Boris, not on Twitter. Kevin, not on Twitter, Boris. Mark Hendricks, what's he gone for? He's got a point for saying... He's got a point.
Well done,
Mark. You've had a bit of a mare. Warsaw to get relegated, 1 point. Uno point. Playoffs, he went for Scunthorpe and Southend, so Wimbledon to finish 14th.
This points thing's getting me into the habit for Eurovision next week.
Yeah, that will just be you.
Can I just quickly, very quickly say off topic, my wife has bought my son Thomas two outfits to wear for Eurovision. One that's got Du Point on, which Great Britain never get, and I think she's got like a Union Jack trousers and stuff. The poor kid is going to be like, you say that I abuse him by getting to sport Wimbledon.
Be very careful.
Or I'm, you know, he is going to basically, he's going to be a Eurovision kid. Bless him, eh? Poor little boy. Anyway, off topic.
Yeah, I don't know. Sort of depressed me thinking about certain things there, but anyway. Me, what did I go for? Point there for Portsmouth in the playoffs. Point for saying Warsaw would be relegated. Point for Bradford being relegated. 3 points puts me joint top with George on 3 points. Two to go. It's you and Paul Raymond. We'll start with Paul Raymond. Paul gets... Cool. Points for Sunderland and Portsmouth in the playoffs, so 2 points. Point for Bradford getting relegated. Point for Warsaw getting relegated. 4 points. Paul Raymond is in the lead, top of the league. Paul Raymond. So, Stu, you're the only person that can knock Paul off the top of the table.
Unlikely.
Let's have a look. Champions, Peterborough United.
Oops.
In fairness, I should have gone through some of mine, actually. I know we're running through them, but... I went Charlton to win the league. I said Burton Albion would be runners-up. Mm. And I think they would have been up there if it wasn't for their League Cup run, okay?
Yeah, I'll give you that.
I had Luton in the playoffs, Peterborough in the playoffs, Barnsley and Portsmouth. Oh, that's not bad. That's four of the top seven.
Yeah.
I had Scunthorpe to finish 14th. Mm. Doncaster to get relegated. They ended up in the playoffs. Blackpool to get relegated. Mm. 15th I had us down as. So you had Peterborough to go up, Luton as runners-up, so you did sort of say they'd be up automatically. Your playoff game is strong. Sunderland, Charlton, Barnsley and Portsmouth. 3 points.
Yeah.
That's good. Fleetwood 14th, no. Warsaw, that's your fourth point.
Oh,
you need one more point to be the outright winner. As it stands, you are joint winners with Mr. Raymond. You need one more point.
I don't think I got it.
Relegated teams. Your other three were Shrewsbury Town.
Ooh.
Doncaster Rovers.
Ouch.
Accrington Stanley.
Ah, damn.
You can still do it if you correctly predicted that we would finish 20th in League One. You need this to say 20th, Stu.
Okay.
What do you think you went for?
So I think I went for higher than that. I went about 15th I went for, I think.
You went for 12th.
Yeah, see, that was because Neil Ardley said we had our strongest team ever. I believe
blaming it on Neil Ardley.
Yeah, blame it on Neil Ardley.
Well, you've still won. You are joint winner.
Yeah, I can live
Paul
with that.
Raymond. We'll have to get comment from Paul at another time, Stu, but really, you should probably collect the trophy on behalf of the pair of you, really. So here we go. Can we have your speech? Is this where you do your speech?
How is it? Well, I obviously know a bit more what I think I know. So I look forward to defending my record next season.
That was your big acceptance speech?
Yeah, well, I don't get to, hey, look, we just survived on the last day of the season. Nobody should be doing acceptance speeches in this current climate.
I feel like that should be another podcast tagline. No one should be doing acceptance speeches in this current climate. That go for everything across every sphere of public life? I don't know. There we go. Predictions. Last prediction. Who's going up from the playoffs? Charlton, Portsmouth, Sunderland, Doncaster. Who's your pick?
I think Charlton will. And you'll laugh now because they got the best. They got the top goal scorer. They got Lars on form. I think Sunderland will choke. I fancy Charlton to go up. And not because of Lyle. I just think whoever the top goal scorer is, you've got a 20 goal scorer. Okay, sorry, I'm giving it away now. I'm watching Tranmere Forest Green. Someone's just gone flying into the crowd big time. I just think, you know, you've got a 20 goal scorer. I think Charlton are a very good side. And it won't be Sunderland, put it that way. They're choke. Because it's just too much pressure on them.
Thomas's birthday today. Did you get him a life-size cardboard cutout of Lyle Taylor, or are you keeping that to yourself?
He don't need to. He's met him. He's met the legend himself already, hasn't he? Do you know what I mean?
He doesn't know he's met Lyle Taylor, though.
Yeah, I've probably shown a picture.
Probably
shown a picture.
There's no problem about it.
And I'm sure Lyle and us will bump into each other at some point in the near future.
When he joins you on your nighttime joints to stand behind Lyle's bins and try and take a photo.
I couldn't possibly say what we got Thomas for his birthday, but let's just say there are some Wimbledon goodies for him.
Right. Why can't you possibly say this, Stu? Because it's Saturday.
Because he might be listening.
But Stu, he's not going to be listening until after. Yeah.
That's a very good point.
Yeah.
Yes. So I got him the home and away top. For Wimbledon, I think up to 2 years.
We had to clarify for Wimbledon there.
Yeah.
Not for Bristol Rovers.
No, I may get him an England top because obviously European League and stuff like that. And we've got him. He's just growing so big now, so we had to get him quite a big shirt for him to grow into because it's like 20, how much are they now? 28 quid or something for the kiddie sizes. Which I think are going down next year, I believe, talking to Matt, which is good.
You think we're going down next season?
No, prices are going down for children's clothes at certain ages, I believe, which is good because I think they are a bit pricey at the moment. But yeah, he will proudly have his home and away top. So last year at King's Meadow, next year he'll be in a full kit.
We hope it's the last season. We hope it's not a Spurs situation, but we'll see. We shall see. Well, that's pretty much us done for the season. This might become the part of the podcast now where, if it not already has become this, where we just ramble for a bit. Motorway service station news, Stu. A return of a podcast favourite because you obviously had a few to visit on the weekend. Oh. We're losing listeners at this point.
Yeah, do you know what? We stopped at Leicester Forest on the way back, which is one of the better ones because you can basically have KFC and that on the flyover. See, basically, you can watch the cars go past and have a KFC if you're a geek like I am sometimes. But the funny thing was, we stopped there.
Sorry, that sounds like the saddest date night ever invented.
probably.
Get some KFC and sit on the motorway bridge and look at the traffic.
But the funny thing was, we stopped, so we parked up. I then noticed that there was a couple of unofficial coaches there. One was, I knew Jonesy and Finchie and that were all on. So I was like, oh, great, that'd be fun. And then the official coaches turned up. And I was like, oh, this is going to be so funny. Because, of course, you've got sober ones, you've got drunk ones. And,
option there? It's like you're about to list them off. Oh, you've got the sober ones and the drunk ones and the
other
sober ones.
Which you won't say. The happy ones. Very happy ones. But the funny thing was is that it was probably was about 9:30, 10:00. And KFC, apparently, there was a manager who said, oh, we can't serve you all because we're shutting. And I think basically got told, there's loads more coming up. You don't really want to close with all these people. And they stayed open for another hour. And it was, everyone was just happy. I've never seen so many women and fans in a service station. It was just a really happy time. Leicester Forest, last day of the seasons, KFC, went down very nicely.
Careful with your phrasing. But there you go. I'm glad to hear it. Very, very happy. I'm glad you enjoyed your final day of the season, KFC.
Thank you.
And on that note, we'll bring it to a close. So, what's happening over the summer, everybody? Well, we are planning, aren't we? This is our intention, as I sort of mentioned earlier. We're going to have a sit down and have a sort of end of season review. We're going to get other members of the podcast team involved. We need to plan this out and work out when this is going to happen. But essentially, sometime, hopefully in the next few weeks, one bonus edition of the podcast will be available. Just keep your eyes out on 9yrspodcast.org, iTunes and YouTube, and all those things you subscribe to get our podcast. Please look out. We will be, won't we, sitting down over the summer to work out what we want to do for next season. We've got lots of ideas. We need to see if they will actually come to pass and how we can make them work, but we want to do lots and lots of things, so hopefully we will find a way to do that. Love Sport Radio keep going on at us about continuing the Wimbledon fan show over the summer break. We're quite happy to do it, I think, but we might veer off topic a lot, especially around the end of May, first week of June, that sort of time. That's going to be some hard going, but hey, there we go. So keep listening, 8 p.m. Sundays for that. I think that pretty much is it, Stu. Time to say our thank yous, because I don't know how we've managed to do the podcast this year, Stu, especially since January. It's really been an effort. We can't lie. It's been hard work. It has been, because funnily enough, we have time. Well, we don't have much time. We have other things we have to do with our lives, but we've made it work and we've had more listeners than ever this season. Highest listening figures we've ever had. So thank you very much to everybody that downloads the show, listens to the show every week, who interacts with us on social media, that comes to chat to us on match days and everything. Support is much appreciated. If you're not listening and if you're not interacting, then there's no podcast. So we thank you greatly for that, and we hope you continue to enjoy what we do and our output that we put out there in the future as well. So, can't be done without you as ours either, Stu. Well, it was last week, but we'll gloss over that one.
Yes, I heard. Well, I listened. It's a do you know what, to do a weekly podcast for as long as we do is tough, but I can say, I enjoy it. I enjoy the fact that people somehow enjoy listening to my stupidity, although some people admitted that it actually puts them to sleep. Cormac would be one of the people, I will say, who says that. Although, did Cormac say recently he managed to stay up to listen to the whole podcast, which I was quite amazed at.
Cormac says he normally can't stay up for more than about half an hour. So he's done well.
He's done well there. But yeah, I would just like to say, do you know what, thank you. It's really nice when I go on away games and home games and people come up and thank us for doing the podcast. We love doing it. We don't get any money for doing it. Don't know why, Nick. But we do it
I keep all the profits to
you
myself.
Keep all the profits. Yes, but we love doing it. And just know anyone out there who's listening to our stupidity is great. And but I will say, I'm so looking forward to the summer. I can't deny it. Oh, 4, 5, 6 weeks off, and then I'm sure I will be down for pre-season because I'm like a little kid, even at the age of my age. I sort of don't give my age away.
There's our game for this week on Twitter, at 9YRS Podcast, everyone. How old do you think Stuart Deakins is? I'm 25. Simple maths will get you there. Anyway, I think that is it.
Yes.
As you say, it is a pleasure to do it. Thank you very much to everyone that continues to listen. As you say, putting up with the nonsense. And I'm going to sign off now. I'm going to say goodbye. Cool. It's time to say goodbye. AFC Wimbledon Business Club this week, they are going adventure landscaping with former Wimbledon goal machine, Carl Leeburn. Pat Mustard doesn't want a dog. And that's why we can't have the mum. Alexa Bliss, bag first, milk last. we'll hopefully speak to you again in the not too distant future, but we will definitely be speaking to you again in August.
Boobs is what they want.